Let the church say amen. As Robert was singing, watch this now. As Robert was singing, I thought about in Acts chapter 3. That was a man now, help me a little bit on the red, Harvey. That was a man who had been lame from his mother's womb. In other words, for 40 years, this boy could not walk. Now watch this. And they brought him and they laid him at the gate of beautiful. I'm talking, this is in your Bible. They took this boy and they laid him at the gate of beautiful. Now his job was to ask alms from those who came in. In other words, he was a beggar. He had begged so much until he had become a professional beggar. In other words, butler, he almost could look at you and tell whether you would be willing to give him any money or not. Well, the Bible says as he laid at the gate, sitting there, he noticed that two preachers was about to come. And the Bible says that when he came, he asked them for a handout. Now don't miss this, Ford, because the preacher told him, he said, now silver and gold have I none. If I had time, I'd take it to Mark 9 or Mark 10 to show you why they didn't have no silver and gold. God told him to leave and don't take nothing. He said, silver and gold have I none. He said, but such as I have, I give unto thee. And the Bible says that they took this boy by the right hand and immediately, that's the power of the text. The power is in the immediately. He said, immediately his ankle bones were strengthened. But you got to see something, Felita. Instead of going back to tell his mama, instead of going back to the hills, the Bible says that he went into the temple. They're not seeing the same. The Bible says that he, are you there?
Yes, sir.
They looking like it ain't in the book. Read, man.
And he leaping up.
Wait a minute. Okay. Now when he said immediately, get that.
And he took him by the right hand.
Took him by the right hand and raised him up.
And immediately. His feet and ankle bone
received strength. Read.
And he leaping up stood.
He leaped
and walked.
And walked.
And entered him into the temple.
Notice now, instead of going back telling everybody that he was raised, that he was healed, the Bible says that he went into the temple. And the Bible says what?
Walking and leaping.
You better get this. If that boy was here today, I bet you he would say, I love to praise. If that boy was sitting around today, I believe he would say, I love to praise his holy name. Beloved, when God has done something for you in your life, I don't know how in the world you cannot want to praise his holy name. When you understand that it wasn't a doctor, he might have healed you through the doctor. If you tell the truth, your marriage shouldn't be together. Come on, let's be real up in here. If it was not for the hand of God, you wouldn't have had that job. That you didn't qualify. Somehow you think you knew somebody and they worked some stuff out. It was God. Maybe I'm in the wrong place. He hadn't done nothing for nobody in here. Huh? Have you crossed any bridges in your life? Beloveds, when God make a way out of no way, I can't see how even somebody could tell somebody else they shouldn't praise the Lord. I didn't go to the doctor with you. I don't know what you're going through in your life. I don't know how hard you've been praying for a runaway child. I don't know what the doctor saw on your x-rays, and I don't know if you're free or you're thinking about being, I don't know what's going on. And when we sing a song like I love to praise him, who am I to tell you it don't take all of that? I don't know what it takes for you. I don't know what it takes for you. When I look back over my life and see where he's bought me from, I can't help but to praise God. Something way down on the inside is being manifest on the outside. And every now and then, I just like to wave my hand. Every now and then, I like to say, Lord, thank you Thank you, Lord, because if the truth should be known, I should be in somebody's graveyard or laying up on my back, tore up from the floor up. But God allowed me to make it in here. And I'm praising him today because yesterday I made 60 years of living. When I look around at all of the people that I grew up with, you better get this. When I look at folk that I grew up with and people that I've been around all my life, there are so many class of 73 that I graduated with that's in the graveyard. So many that are in the penitentiary. Come on now. Don't be looking like ain't nothing like that in your family. So many of those that I graduated with can't do this. So many of those are strung out on crack cocaine. But God has blessed my life. And when you sing, I love to praise him, I love. And I'll praise him by myself if I have to. Because he's been mighty, mighty good to me. Is that all right? Is that all right? Yes, somebody ought to say amen. Amen. God is such a good God. And he'll fix it for you if you let him. We want to sit around here and act like he ain't never did nothing and act like your little degree got you where you are and sitting up here and acting like you ain't never stepped on a roach in your life. You done some stuff. Yeah, you done some stuff. Probably did something last week. I barely had a home. But I'm glad to be home. There's no place like home. Man, let me tell you this. We have restricted people in praising God. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 3:17, and I dare you to take the text in its context. He says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, that's liberty. That's liberty. Man, them Jews was trying to hold them people under the law. They were trying to hold them under the law. And Paul wrote and told them, he said, man, where the Spirit of the Lord is, you got some liberty, man. You are no longer under bondage. We bondage people. We try to regulate service like a thermostat. Sit it on 75 and it can't go no higher or can't go no lower. You don't know what's going on in my body. Might be a balling over. And then what messed me up about this, and I got a long way to go, I don't know why I'm doing this, but what messed me up about this is we are saying where the Spirit of the Lord is, how'd that song go to? Let the Spirit of the Lord rise among us, and then when the Spirit started rising, we get to looking at folk crazy. You just sung the song. If you don't want the Spirit to rise, stop singing. If you wanted to, okay. Welcome to the worship service. And I hope, trust, and pray that you're here for none other reason than to worship God. I better move now because there's a lot I want to cover this morning. Thank you for your prayers. We had a wonderful meeting on last week, and I didn't know what I was getting myself into, but it really turned out to be a good meeting after I got there to see what was really going on and to be able to try to help the church, and I was really, really impressed. But I want to tell you something. I'm troubled, y'all.
Yeah.
I'm troubled because, number one, there's so much trouble in our brotherhood. Beloved, right now, and I try to hide so much from the church because I don't want you hung up on all of this foolishness. Yeah. That's going on in our city. I try to let you know as less as possible, but this is blown up. And you gon' know, so I want you to know. So I'm gonna tell you. They've come in now to where there's another group of members of the body that's starting a national lectureship because they say that this lectureship that we have is not sound. And this one is going against this lectureship and it's tearing up and it hurts my heart. It hurts my heart. They took a whole lectureship in Dallas to preach against a few people. Not once on the YouTube that I heard did they say anything about Jesus. They were too busy trying to show who's right and who's wrong and fussing over things that don't matter while people are dying and losing their soul. they are so concerned, and I have some concerns as well about the One Church Conference. But my thing, I stood up and said, if you don't agree with it, then don't go. Stop trying to pause on everybody else's mind. I had some issues, and I went to the guy who put it on. I ain't going to you. You can't tell me nothing but what you think. Beloved, it's hurting me to my heart. Families are breaking apart. Marriages are busting up. And it's hurting me to my heart. Man, our kids go to school on Monday, and now they've got metal detectors at the doors, because now in school kids are carrying guns and knives. It's more guns in the school than it is at the police department. And it's hurting me to my heart. So after the Holy Spirit began to tug on my mind, I thought I would put together a lesson. Listen to me, church, because we'll be in a Sunday school mode. Put together a lesson to teach you how to pray in the heat of the battle. We always tell folk they ought to pray, but we never teach them how. Are y'all ready for this? Second Chronicles chapter 20. Second Chronicles chapter 20. Woo. Lord Jesus, just take over this place. Now watch me scare half of y'all to death. We're going to preach the whole 20th chapter, but I'm only read two verses. Oh, Lord, that old brother Glenn. Andre told you I'd be back today, didn't he? Yeah, I'm back. Your preacher is back. I love this word, and I'm going to tell you, this is what's going to save us in the last day. Nothing's wrong with good singing, but you're going to need a word from the Lord. And if you don't need this word today, Wednesday, Thursday, you'll say, oh, I see why he preached what he preached last week. Look at verse 15 for time's sake. Verse 15, and our screens are out, unfortunately. During the funeral on yesterday, Robert preached the screens out. So we'll have them up. We'll have them up. We know how it, and that's why you can't rely on man-made things, because you don't ever know when it's going to go out. But this ain't going to ever. Talk back to him if you can. Look at verse number 15. And said, hearken ye all Judah, an inheritance of Jerusalem, and the king Jehoshaphat, thus said the Lord unto them, be not afraid or be dismayed by reason, for this great multitude, for this battle is not yours, it's God's. For tomorrow we'll go down against and behold all of them from the cliff of Zeph, and we'll find them at the end of the brook, behold, in the wilderness of Judah. Spirit of the living God, take teach us from your word, Lord. Help us to see what you would have us to see. Somebody tonight is in the midst of a battle and don't know which way to turn. Speak to me that I could speak to them. And we'll be very careful to give you praise, honor, and glory. And all of God's children said amen. You may be seated this morning. I just want to talk to you from the subject, praying in the heat of battle. Praying in the heat of battle. Beloved, it's a fact that every one of us are going to go through some battles. I don't care who your mama is. I don't care how much money you got in the bank. I don't care what your 401k look like. In this life, you are going to have to go through some battles. Life is not just sunshine. But look, I want you to know that there's going to be some health battles. There are going to be some wealth battles. There are going to be some people battles, in-laws, outlaws, church members, co-workers. There are going to be some battles in your life, Damien. I want you to know there are going to be some internal battles. Some of us are going to struggle with who I am and what I'm supposed to do and what's my purpose in life. You see people going from one career to another because they are struggling with who I am or what am I here to do. Beloved, life is one battle after another. Sometimes, beloved, these battles will knock you to your knees. But let me ask you a question. How do you deal with the battles in your life when the battles are dealing with you? Y'all missed it. How do you deal with the battles in your life when the battles are dealing with you? Do you take it upon yourself to fix it? Do you take it out on others? Or do you just hope it go away? It just go away. Beloveds, I believe the text that has been read in your hearing can help you handle these battles and rearrange your prayer life. Because sooner or later, you are going to have to use or need the supernatural power of God. Every one of us, sooner or later, is going to have a burst of God's supernatural power. I want you to know that this text can help us to see how we're supposed to pray. Now, here it is. It unfolds. Go back now to verse 1 of chapter 20, and let me set this text up. For the Bible says, after this, boy, so much preaching right there, it's unreal. But it'll take me in another direction. I got it at 7:30, some of it anyway. He said, now watch this. After this, the Moabites and the Ammonites and some of the Mennonites came to make war on Jehoshaphat. Beloved, you've got to understand that a huge army now has crossed over the Dead Sea to declare war on Judah, Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, from the southern kingdom where he had been king for 25 years. I want you to know that Jehoshaphat was a good king. There were a lot of bad kings, Ronnie, but this particular king was a good king. He sought the Lord in everything that he did. Just Jehoshaphat tried to bring about a revival in a nation that cared absolutely nothing about God. Jehoshaphat had an army that made up of 1 million men. In other words, God's favor was on Jehoshaphat. You got to see something here, man. His favor, his hand was on Jehoshaphat. And it was his season. It was Jehoshaphat's season. But I better tell you something, because I hear people all the time when you say, how you doing? Well, I'm blessed and highly favored. That does not mean that everything is going good in your life. See, God's favor can be on you and you can be in a storm. Y'all ain't going to talk back to me. Let me show you something. Jehoshaphat was in his season. Watch this now, because verse 2 said, some men. Now, whether you know it or not, the some men here is grace. I like that. She said, help us. Let me show it to you. She said, now, some men came and told Jehoshaphat that a vast army was coming against him from Edom and from the other side of the sea. Now, they didn't have to tell Jehoshaphat they were coming. They could have just, but the grace of God was upon him, and men came and said, Jehoshaphat, two armies are coming against you. Let me show you why this is so crucial. Go back to chapter 17, man. Chapter, so y'all stay at the text, but y'all looking like it ain't in your Bible. In chapter 17, verse number 3. In chapter 17, verse 3. Here's what the Bible says. And the Lord was with Jehoshaphat because he walked in the way of his father David. I left a word out. In the first way of his father David. You see, David's first way was good. His latter way was bad. But the text says that he walked in the first way of his father David and sought not unto Balaam. Beloveds, drop down to verse 10 of chapter 17. The Bible says, and the fear of the Lord fell upon all the kingdoms. It fell upon all the kingdoms. It fell upon all the kingdoms of the land. And that was around Judah, so that they made no war against Jehoshaphat. Now you gotta see it now. God has fixed it where they was not going to make any war against Jehoshaphat. So now these men came and said, man, it's two armies that is coming against you. That knocked him to his knees because he was not expecting. Come on, y'all. See, God's favor was so strong on Jehoshaphat until the news frightened him. Now, go back to the text. Go back to the text. Go back to chapter 20. The Moabites and the Ammonites and some of the Minnikites came to make war. In verse 3, and I'm gonna give you the text and we'll unpack it. In verse 3, Jehoshaphat was alarmed. Where did this come from? Look what he said. Jehoshaphat resolved into inquiring of the Lord and proclaimed a fast of all Judah. In verse 6, watch this, Brookman. He gets an answer. He prays in verse 6. Listen to his prayer. He says, "Oh God, oh Lord God, our Father, are you not the God who is in heaven, who rule over all the kingdoms of the nation?" He says, "Power and might is in your hand, and no one can withstand thee." That was his prayer in verse 6. His answer is in verse 14. Stay with me now. The Bible says, "And as he stood in the assembly, the Spirit of the Lord came to Jehoshaphat, and he prophesied what God wanted Jehoshaphat to hear." Here's his prophecy in verse 17. I'm trying to teach you something this morning. Look at verse 17. The Bible says, "You will not have to fight this battle." Notice now, Jehoshaphat came and told Jehoshaphat, "I know it don't look good, but you will not have to fight this battle." He said, "Now take up the position, stand fast, and see the deliverance of the Lord, O Judah and Jerusalem. Don't be afraid. Don't be discouraged." He says, "Go and face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you." Beloved, you better get this. Sometimes God's ways seem to be so difficult. Wow. It says Jehoshaphat was such a good king, and God wasn't going to let him fight the battle, Sister Tarver. How come he just didn't move it? Why, Lord, you're not going to let me fight it. Make it go away. Seems like the reasonable thing to do, beloved. But I want you to know something. Difficult times have a tendency to reveal our true character. See, it's easy to say, "I love the Lord" when the sun is shining. It's easy to say, "I love the Lord" when my refrigerator is full. It's easy to say, "I love the Lord" when my marriage is going good. But what happens when my back is, I wish I had praying folk, when my back is against the wall? See, difficult times bring out the real you. You sitting in here, we're singing, "I love to praise," because things are going well. What if the doctor told you on Friday that "I see some cancer cells in your body"? Could you still say, "I love to"? Yeah. Talk back to me if you can. Watch this. Watch this now. You got to see this. You got to see this. You got to see this. In verse 20, look what happens. He said, "Now have faith in the Lord your God, and he will uphold you. Have faith. Have faith in the prophecy, and you shall be successful." Here's what we teach you. I've been teaching you this for years. This is what is called the practice and the promise. He said, "Now if you have faith," then that's the practice. The practice is you've got to have faith. You've got to do your part. He said, "When you do your part, then God..." Talk back to me, church. See, we want God to do his part, but we don't want to do... He said, "Now, if you just keep your faith..." Now, here's what I want you to see. Let's back up, and I'm going to slow down, and I'm going to have you out of here in about... I want to slow down and unpack this thing. Now, let's go back. Jehoshaphat was working his kingship. He was doing his godly work. Two men, Prince, came and said, hey, the Moabites and the Ammonites and some of the Midianites is coming to get you. I better stop and I got to feed you right here, because you can be doing what God has told you to do and the devil will stop. You can have your cross around your neck, your Bible under your arm, stopping at every red light, not cussing out your co-worker, and the devil will still. Jehoshaphat was doing his thing, man. He was living for God, holding up the bloodstained banner, and two armies came against him. Now, look at verse 3, though. Verse 3, when the Bible says that when he came, his natural reaction was fear. It was fear. Beloved, you got to see it. It's there. See, let me tell you something. It was his natural reaction when he received this devastating news. It's our natural reaction as well, Michelle. See, when the doctor says that he sees something and you need to come back, we fear. Watch this. You got to see it. When the job announced that there's going to be a mass layoff, we fear, especially if you're the breadwinner and you know, your wife ain't working and it's up to you to pay the bill and they finna talk about, man, but it creates fear. You see, you gotta understand something. I'm sure that there's some people who are here today, there's a crisis in your life right now. Yes. And there's some form of fear in your life. Let me tell you what fear is. Fear is an unpleasant emotion introduced by danger and pain. Now, this emotional fear has been hardwired into all of us. It's in us, man. We've been hardwired with this fear. You see, that is what is called a amygdala, which is in us. It's shaped like a cluster of almonds. It sits. Our brain is made up of a medulla oblongata, a cerebellum, and then on the inside of that is this block of fear. It's in you, man, it's in me, it's in all of us. So when we get devastating news, the first thing we do is we fear. So now we find here that Jehoshaphat feared. But I love this. Verse 3 tell us that he set himself to seek God and to proclaim a fast. Now the word set here means that he positioned himself. Now in Bible times, walk with me, I'm gonna shout you in a minute, but in Bible times, when one was to pray, he had to be a certain way. He had to hold his palms toward the east, and he prayed at 3, at 9, 12, and 6. But now you know and I know it's not the position. It's not the position. It was the position then. Now it's the condition. Talk back to me now. See, that's why when we pray, we have to have the right condition. You know, and I was telling him at 7:30 this morning, one of the things that I do in my prayer is when I begin, I said, Lord, if it's anything in my life that's separating me or stopping you from hearing this prayer, will you move it? Because I want to see, sin stops prayers from being heard. Come on, y'all don't look like this. I'm trying to get to the good part. The Bible says, for the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ear, they looking funny. Isaiah 59, verse 1 and 2. They looking, I better prove this. Let me tell you something. So I ask God, if it's anything that's stopping you, because it's not my position anymore, it's the condition of my heart. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 59, verse 1 and 2, the Bible says what?
Behold, the Lord's hand is not short.
He said God's hand is not shortened.
That it cannot save.
That it cannot save.
Neither his ear heavy.
His ear is not heavy.
That it cannot hear.
That he cannot hear.
But your iniquity.
But your what?
Your iniquity.
But your what?
Iniquity.
But your sins.
Have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you.
So it's not. So it's not the position. It's the condition. So watch this. Jehoshaphat was alarmed, and he set himself to praise God. Now you got to see this now. When the battles come in our lives, we always suggest people, you need to pray, you need to pray, you need to pray, but we never teach them how to pray. Beloveds, I'm going to teach you how to pray, how to get your prayer up today. Don't go to sleep. Hunt your spouse and say, baby, you need to hear this. Watch this here. Because if your prayer is wrong, then your answer, talk back. I better say it again. If your prayer is wrong, then your answer is wrong. Somebody say, well, how in the world can you have a wrong prayer? Let me teach you. Psalms 109. Come on. He in here reading the Sunday school book. He said, He read it. Watch this. Let me teach you a wrong prayer. Watch this here. In Psalms, just for time, say, drop down to verse 6.
Set thou a wicked man.
Now let me tell you what's going on. David now is upset. Saul is trying to kill him, and he's upset. He wants to get. So he's going to pray. But listen to this prayer. He said, do what?
Set thou a wicked man over him.
David said, set a wicked man over him. Read.
Let Satan stand at his right hand.
He said, now let's set a wicked man over him, and then let Satan stand at his right hand. Read.
When he shall be judged, let him be condemned.
He said, in the judgment, let him be condemned. This is a wrong prayer, y'all read.
And let his prayer become sin.
He said, let his prayer, that's cold, man. That man said, man, let your prayer become sin. Read.
Let his days be few.
He said, let his days be few.
And let another take his office.
He said, let another man replace him. Read.
Let his children be fathers.
No, not only did he pray about David, not even to pray about the man's children. That's wrong, y'all. He said, let his children be what?
Fatherless.
He said, let his children be fatherless. Read.
And his wife a widow.
Let his wife be a widow. Now, what kind of prayer is this? This is a wrong prayer. Read.
Let his children be continually vagabonds and beg.
David, this is a man after God's own heart, y'all. He said, let the man's children be vagabonds.
And beg.
Read.
Let them seek their bread also out of the desolate places.
He didn't say go to Chick-fil-A and eat. He said, you go to the desolate place. Are you hearing this? Man, this is a man that's praying. See, that's why I'm trying to tell you. If your prayer is wrong, then your answer, can you see? Talk back to me, y'all. Some of us are praying wrong. Selfishly. We learn it from a child. You know, when mama made you get on the side of the bed, she taught you one of the most selfish prayers in the world. Now you lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul you keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord the soul, my soul you take. You ain't prayed for nobody but yourself. We teach our children that. Are you seeing this? Beloved, but if our prayers are wrong, then our answer is going to be wrong. You finished reading David's prayer. David is, don't make no sense. Watch this right here. But let me tell you something. Here's exactly how many of us pray, just like David. We don't pray for our enemies. Lord, let that old supervisor have a wreck. Let her car freeze up, because she's hard to deal with. She's prejudiced and all of that. But you still don't pray wrong. Lord, bless her. The Bible says in Luke chapter 6, he says, pray for them that despitefully use you. You learn how to pray for your enemy. Okay, watch the text. Let me ask you something. Here's three things. Three questions that have to be asked before you pray any prayer. Here's what you have to ask yourself. Number one, am I willing to accept God's answer just like God give it? Come on. Am I willing to accept his answer just like he give it? Number two, am I going to leave my preconceived notions and receive God's answer and God only? And then number three, am I going to cooperate with God, or do I expect God to cooperate with me? Beloveds, before you pray any prayer, you need to ask yourself those three things. Though, Lord, whatever answer, we'll sing it. Any way you bless me, Lord, we'll sing it. And then when he bless you, but not that way. But any way that he answers your prayer, Jamel, are you going to be able to accept it? Can we go deeper? Let's go deeper, y'all. Here's what I want you to know. First thing I want you to know about prayer is you need to understand that God cares about your battle. Whew. Actually, we should have did this in a series, because I could have worked on this one for the longest. But the first thing you need to do is say, God, I want you to know, is God, he cares about your battle. Beloveds, the Bible teaches us, please listen to me. The Bible teaches us in Matthew chapter 10, verse 30, that every hair on your head is numbered. Now, he wasn't talking to Robert. I mean, he's talking to Jamaica. but wait a minute. You got to get it. He wasn't talking to you, man. He's talking to me. What I'm trying to say, here's what I want you to get. Don't miss this. If God took time to number the hairs on your head, little girl, surely he knows the desires of your heart. Are y'all seeing this? If he can tell you, and you know what, I don't know about you, because I'm 60 now, every time I brush my hair, some of it come out. And he have a new count. Y'all missing this thing? Watch this now. You got to see this, man. You got to see this. See, if you're not careful, you'll be like those disciples was in Mark chapter 4. In Mark chapter 4, you remember Jesus says, y'all go over. He said, let us go over to the other side. And the Bible says that a storm came, and the disciples got in the boat and said, Master, don't you care if we perish? Beloveds, they didn't understand. The disciples' job was not to stop the storm. Their job was not to let the storm stop them. Look. What they missed, Jesus said, let us. Y'all missed it too. Jesus said, let us go over. Jesus is in the boat too. Are you seeing this? He didn't say it wouldn't be no storm. You wouldn't have bad weather. Jesus says that when we get on the other, we are going over to the other side. We might have a tornado. It might be a hurricane. But when we end up, beloveds, God cares about your battle. You see, you must understand, God is not moved by storms. He's moved by faith. See, you must understand, God knows and God cares about your prayer. He knows about your depression. He knows about your grieving. He knows about your career. He knows about your health. He knows. Not only do he know, he cares. He knows about your loneliness. He knows and he cares about it. Do you understand that God knows about your care? That's why Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse number 7, cast all your cares upon me because I care it for you. Let me go a little deeper. Jehoshaphat understood this truth. Jehoshaphat said, it's not my control to control the Moabites and the Ammonites. He says, my job is to keep faith in the middle of it. Right, look at verse 6. The Bible says, oh Lord, God of our fathers. Can I tell you something? This is very important that Jehoshaphat began his prayer like this. This is the same way when you and I get into a relationship with God. Here's when we are baptized for the remission of our sin, baptism puts us into Christ, then a covenant is created. We become children of God, then my concerns become his concerns. His concerns become my concerns. Yesterday after the funeral, I had the privilege of marrying this girl right here. We married her. Right here. Can I tell you something? I told that man, I said, man, meet me in my office. We walked down there. I said, now, you taking on a wife, her concerns become your concerns. See, when you come into, I was telling these young people, man, I'm finna marry sister, but she got all of them school loans. Oh, your school loans now. They're your school loans now. Because what she's, come on, talk back to me, man. Yeah. I married a man and he didn't have no bank account and I had all of this money. His bank account is your bank account now. I ain't get too many amens right there, but it's here true. Yeah, all right, Brother Glenn, you were doing pretty good till you got that. back up. But what I'm trying to tell you, when we get in a covenant relationship with God, then his concerns become our concern. His need, my needs become his needs. That's why I have to be careful what I ask for. I want you to see something right here. Beloved, you got to understand that that's conditional that his concerns become your concern. Here's what I want you to see. This is God. Get by the John 15 and 7. That'll work good. This is God. Right. The Bible says, God and the Son, this is the Son. and stepped on.
Yes. Come on.
I don't care how bad to look.
Come on.
The Bible says, when you get in me.
And my words abide in you.
Abide in you.
You shall ask what you will. Yeah.
Only. If you're in Christ. You say, if you are in Christ, and I'm in, and you in me, then you can ask. Yeah. See, our problem is we're not in Christ, and we asking, and we're not getting. He never promised you. Second thing you got to know, man, look at that time. That clock looked like it's got steroids or something. Second thing you need to know is God is greater than your problem. He's bigger than your battle. Y'all not feeling me up in here. God is bigger. Look at verse 6. It's right in the text. We textual people here. We're going to have it in the Bible. It's going to be in the Bible. Look what he says. He says, oh Lord, God our Father, are you not the God who is in heaven, who rule over all kingdoms? Who rule over all kingdoms and nations? He said, power and might is in your hand, and no one can withstand you. Is God all powerful? Yes, he is. Is he all knowing? Yes, he is. Is he all merciful? Yes, he is. He had made a covenant relationship with us? Yes, he is. Then why is Jehoshaphat worried and only two armies is coming against him? Y'all missed that. Two armies, man. He said all nations. And now two armies is coming against him. See, he's bigger than that problem. Can I talk to you? He's bigger than your problem. Look, girl, your problem don't intimidate God. Just because you can't find no job, that don't intimidate God. God, he's bigger than that. Just because you have some health issues, God's bigger than that. Oh yeah, he's bigger than that. He can fix your marriage, man. He's bigger than your little old marriage. Are y'all seeing this? But we don't trust him. We won't stretch out on him. He's bigger than your problem. He's much bigger. In verse number 10. Let me tell you something. We serve a big God. And you know what bothers me about the church? We pray so small. Thurman, we pray small, man. Lord, man, he'll get you a liver, a kidney. Whatever you're looking for, trust him, man. But our mind is so small. Our mind is so small. Lord, if it be over here, please. Listen to what he says. Psalm 50 and 10, the Bible says what?
For every beast of the forest is mine.
He said, now number one, every beast out there in the forest is mine. Read.
And the cattle upon a thousand hills.
He says, a cattle upon a thousand hills is mine. Read.
I'm over all the fowls of the mountain.
He says, I'm over all the fowls of the mountain. Read.
The wild beasts of the field.
Now watch this next verse. This knocked my socks off. Read.
If I were hungry.
He said, now just in case I was hungry.
I wouldn't tell.
I'm not hungry, but I'm not developed. But if I was,
I wouldn't
God
tell
says, I wouldn't tell you. Because you can't do nothing about it. Man, God is bigger than our problem, man.
Well, the world is mine.
Lord, have mercy, Jesus. Watch this, watch this, watch this, watch this, watch this. Let me give you a little more of this. Let me give you a little more of that. See, what does it mean that God is bigger than our problem? See now, this is my son. This is my boy. My boy, my oldest kid right here. If I could, I would have a business and I would be retiring because I'm 60 and my son will be taking over. Yeah. That's what I would do. Well, I'd do that for you. But I don't have the resources. I can't do that, even though I want to do it. I can't. Are you seeing this? See, God has. Oh, you missing this. Not only do he want to do it, he's got the resources. He's bigger than your problem, man. Oh, your that little marriage of yours can work. All you got to do is trust him. Stop listening to your girlfriend. Leave Oprah alone, who ain't never been married. It can work. You go around on your refrigerator, I can do all things. Well, why you got unreconcilable difference? Boy, I got some stuff up here and I ain't even to the point. Somebody say, you better go on finish. That don't get you ain't to the good part. Well, I said, see, I want you to see this though. The way you pray indicates whether or not you believe God is greater than your problem. Lord, see, do you believe today that God is greater than your problem? Do you believe that? Yeah. Here's what Lord, the doctor called me in. He wanted to run some more tests. Oh, Lord. Lord, the school called me. My little boy messed up. Oh, Lord. Lord, I don't no longer want to be in this marriage. Oh, Lord, let me tell you something. Once you establish the fact that God is greater than your bankruptcy, he's greater than your depression, he's greater than that mountain in your life, once you establish the fact, you are halfway with your answer. Okay, let me give you a little more. Here's something else you got to do. You got to understand that when you pray, God has to be your first response. Ooh, I could work here. Look at verse 1. The Moabites and the Ammonites and some of the Midianites came to make war with Jehoshaphat. Verse 2 says his initial reaction was fear, and then he seeked to pray the Lord. I was reading in Reader's Digest about a woman who went to the doctor, and the doctor says, well, there ain't nothing else we can do. All we can do now is pray. She said, oh, it doesn't come down to that. You see, prayer was her last result and not her first. See, prayer has to be your first response. When something comes in your life, prayer have, okay, y'all looking at me funny. You remember that in 2 Kings chapter 20, when Isaiah came to Hezekiah. He said, now Hezekiah, set thy house in order, for you shall not live and you shall die. Verse 2 said that Hezekiah turned his back and fell down on his knees and said, Lord, if you don't mind, I need to be here for the people. Not so much for me, but I got to make a way out of no way for your people. And the Bible says before he got up off of his knees that God sent Isaiah back and told him, I heard your prayer and I added to your life some 15 more years. See, God, when he's your first result, I wish I had prayer folk up in here. He's got to be first. I get people to come in my office talking about, well, Brother Glenn, we just stopped by here on our way downtown to get a divorce. I said, go on, your mind's already made up. Why I have to be the last one? Are you hearing me? Man, God has to be our first result. Let me give you these other two and I'm gonna have to get out of here. Hey, then the next thing I want you to know, he talked about soliciting others for the battle. Let me tell you, Jehoshaphat declared a fast, and he asked all nations to come together. Amen. To pray. Amen. Now, I don't want you to misunderstand this, Darrell, because it's not that you and God is not enough. That's not why he asked the other nations to come, because if the truth must be told, you and God is enough. But he had him to bring other nations for two reasons. Number one, God does not expect us to live on an island. Yes. He expects us to worship together, to love together, to live together, and to pray together. So he said, man, get your brothers in. But be careful who you ask to pray for you. Because some of these folk will pray on the David's prayer. Let his children be vagabonds. Some of these, come on now. They're turning. But watch who you pray. And then make sure the person that you ask to pray can get a prayer up.
Yes, sir.
Some of the best worded prayers don't make it no further than the ceiling.
Amen.
You know, but you solicit somebody who can get a prayer up on your behalf. Are you hearing me? So now the last and final thing I want you to see, and I'm gonna close. It ain't that I'm out of text, I'm just out of time. I got enough text to be in here another 35 minutes. Somebody say you're going to be in here by yourself. But now I want you to see this now. Now your faith take action. There has to be action with your prayer. Let me show you. See, if the truth must be told, we just want God to work it out. Work it out. Just work it out. Just work it out. 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 But let me show you, it takes some action. Your faith takes action. Here's what I want you to see. Drop down to verse 14. No, I tell you, here. Look at verse 17 of the text. Watch this. Verse 17, the Bible says what? The Bible says, and you will not have to fight this battle. He says, take upon your position, stand fast, and see the deliverance of the Lord, of Judah and Jerusalem. Be not afraid, be not discouraged. He says, but go and face them tomorrow. God says, now, I'm gonna work it out for you, but your faith has to be in action. He says, now, you ain't gonna have to fight this fight. He says, but you're going to have to act as if though. Yeah. Watch this. Let's go a little deeper. God's answer requires faith. Look at verse 20. Are you at verse 20? Ooh, I love this, y'all.
And he rose early in the morning.
He got up early the next day. Watch this. I'm done after this, right? Early the next day.
And went forth into the wilderness of Tekoa.
He went in the wilderness of Tekoa.
And
as they went forth,
Jehoshaphat stood and said,
Hear me, O Judah.
And you inhabitants of Jerusalem.
Read.
Believe in the Lord your God.
Read.
So shall you be established.
Read.
Believe his prophets.
Read.
So shall you prosper.
Now watch this. Read.
And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord.
Wait a minute. He appointed what?
Singers.
We're going to war. What we need singers for? Wait a minute, Lord. You got this thing messed up. We're going to fight. You want me to get some singers? I'll get them to sit on the hill while we fight. But these are trained warriors. Man, I can't go to war with no singers. I need some daros to go with me. Some princes where we can knock some stuff. Read.
And they should praise the beauty of holiness.
Wait a minute. We're going to war. You talking about praising? Are y'all seeing this? Man, this blew my mind. I thought I was at home by myself. I was in my office, and I got to reading this thing, and I got to screaming and hollering. Callers running. That boy, you okay? I said, girl, I didn't even know you was in the house. Because I wouldn't have been like that. Man, that thing got good to me, man. Because now, in the midst of the battle, watch this, in the heat of the battle, he tells them to praise God. And then watch what happened. Come on, man, I got to quit. Come on.
They went out before the army and to say, praise the Lord.
Read.
For his mercy endureth forever.
Read.
They began to sing and to praise.
Watch this. Now they out there singing. They got three. They got the Ammonites, the Midianites, and they out there singing, I love to praise. And these other guys over there trying to fight, and the Bible says what?
The Lord set ambushments against the children of Ammon.
God will fight your battle, man. He sent some ambush amongst the people, and guess what? They start fighting against themselves. And when the war, when Judah got over there, the only thing they had to do was pick up the loot. Because this battle was not theirs. It was the Lord. Can I talk to you now? Can we get real right here? Can we just get real, real? I don't know what your battle is. But it's not yours, Denise. I don't know. It's not yours, Joanne. I don't know what it is. But this battle is the Lord. Are you going to continue to praise him in the midst of this battle? Or are you going to throw the towel in and turn your back? Man, you constantly lift up the name of Jesus. And he'll fix this for you. But you've got to be in Christ. You know what? I love every child in here. I don't, hey, it's a few bad ones. We got a few bad kids over here. But for the most part, Belva got some good kids. And I love them all. I love them all. But can I tell you something? They're not in my will. They're not in my, don't look like that. My kids ain't in your will. Look at me like, oh, Brother Glenn, my kids ain't in your will. You know why? Because my kids are not yours. The only kids that's in my will, very little in there, but they're mine. They're mine. They're mine. The only people that are in God's will, oh, y'all to see it, is his children. If you're not his child, then you're not in his will. Well, how do I become adopted into him? I'm glad you asked that question. You become adopted by hearing the word of God, believing it with all of your heart, repenting of your sin, confessing him with your tongue, and being baptized, where the Bible says your operation takes place. Colossians chapter 2. He takes off that old person and he put a new person on. I got to tell you this. I was talking to somebody earlier today and I told you that I would answer your question at the end of the sermon. If you was taught wrong, then you was baptized wrong. I just need to make it plain. Matter of fact, hold for me Acts 19, Prince. I just need to make it plain. My first baptism, me and this girl, baby, we were at, and God knows I'm not trying to make light of no place. As a matter of fact, I preached for Damascus about 3 months ago. But we were baptized at Damascus. Miss you too, she was a Damascus girl. Sure. But I was baptized because I wanted to sing in the junior choir. Now watch this. I didn't want to sing in the junior choir because I could sing. I wanted to sing in the choir because when they came in, they was rocking. And I wanted to get in line and rock. And they told me the only way I can do it was to be baptized. So I got baptized to sing in the junior choir. Beloveds, that's not no reason to get baptized. Baptism is for the remission of the removing of a sin. You remember when those Jews crucified Christ in Acts chapter 2, verse number 36, and when they realized what they had done, they went and said, men and brethren, what shall we do? He says, repent and be baptized, every one of you. Why? For the remission or the removing of your sin. So if you were baptized for an outward sign of an inward faith, you were baptized wrong. As a matter of fact, listen at these disciples in Acts chapter 19. Read.
And it came to pass. While Apollos was at Corinth. Paul came to the upper coast.
He came to Ephesus.
He saw disciples.
Religious people, man, you better listen. He saw disciples, religious people. What were they doing?
Said unto them, He asked them, if you receive the Holy Ghost since you believe. And they said unto him, we have not so much as heard whether there be an Holy Ghost.
What are you talking about? Read.
And he said unto them, unto what then were you baptized?
But what were you baptized? And that's my question. Their question is my question. What were you baptized for? What was the reason of your baptism? If it was not for the remission of your sin, then your baptism is invalid. And you need to be baptized today. They come up with a word, I don't use this, they talk about rebaptize. There ain't no rebaptize, you ain't never been baptized if it wasn't for the remission of sin. Ain't no rebaptize. You need to be baptized. If it wasn't for the remission of your sin, then you need to be baptized. I want everybody to stand to your feet. Somebody got a battle. Somebody got a battle. Yeah. I want to pray for that battle today. I know God is able to move that battle, man. Good to see you, WAP. God bless you, man. God bless you. Somebody's going through a battle. And we want to deal with that battle today. Because this battle is not yours. It's the Lord's, man. Amen. You need to leave it alone. It's not yours. I want to pray with you. If you hadn't been baptized for the remission of your sin, I want you to come. But if you have been, and you've been allowing this battle to get to you, then I want to pray with you. to pray with you. If you're not in step with God, if you're out of tune with God, the Bible says if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you, but you got to confess them. You got to confess your sins. So if you are in a guilty distance from God, then I want you to reconnect today. I was telling you, I use my Surface Pro. Use it, and I done got good on my little computer, private computer. But when I was in Alabama, I tried to plug it up. And Damien, I didn't have it all the way in there. So when I got up the next morning to turn it on, didn't come on. Why? Because it wasn't plugged all the way in. Some of us, man, are not plugged all the way in. And now it's time to be turned on. You can't come on because you don't have no juice. You can reconnect today by coming back. Beloved, if you stand the guilty distance of God, if you're trying to fight your own battle, if you're not allowing the Lord to take this battle from you and deal with it yourself, I pray that you come today. I pray that you don't allow Satan to master your mind and tell you, not now, you're not ready. You don't get ready to come. You come just as you are. The Bible said God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ. If you wait till you get ready, you will never, ever come. When they roll you down here, you see you're trying to get ready. So come now while the Spirit is moving. Sing, son, sing.
Lord, guide my
come on,
feet.
Come on, guide.